the unopinioned nature of React is a two-edged sword. On the one hand, you get freedom of choice. On the other hand, many projects end up with a custom and often messy architecture. This video is the sixth part of a series about software architecture and React apps, where we take a code base with lots of bad practices and refactor it step by step. See my playlist named React Architecture for more videos and check the article linked in the description, where you can find a waitlist for the course. Previously, we created the initial API layer and extracted fetch functions, added data transformations, separated domain entities and DTOs, and introduced infrastructure services using dependency injection. All this to isolate our UI code from the server and increase testability. But we're not done yet. In this video, we're moving closer to the components. From my experience in many React apps, there's no real separation between business logic and UI code. There's no consensus about where to put logic, so it often ends up in a component, a custom hook, or a utility file. This can lead to code that is hard to understand and difficult to test. And that's exactly what we'll address today. Let's have a look at a problematic code example. Here's a component that renders a form with a submit handler attached. The submit handler updates some UI state, checks some preconditions regarding the involved users, saves an image and creates a reply, and finally updates the UI state again. Fairly straightforward, right? There's quite a bit of code inside the submit handler, but what can we do? So what's the problem? The thing is that the component has quite a lot of responsibilities. Some of these fall well into the concern of a UI component, like rendering the UI, handling the submit event, or updating the loading or error state. But much of the code in the submit handler has nothing to do with UI. Most of the code is data validation and orchestrating calls to services or REST APIs. That's business logic and can be isolated from the UI framework. Imagine we wanted to migrate from React to any other future UI library. We'd have to untangle this mixture of UI and business logic. Okay, that's an unlikely event far in the future. More urgent is this question. How would you test this component? Do I hear integration tests? I know, integration tests have become very popular in the React community, especially thanks to React Testing Library and its premise to test an application from the user's perspective. But in this case, we would need to jump through a few hoops to test all the different branches. Each return statement represents one branch, plus the catch block at the end. So we have test scenarios like a user who shouted more than 5 times and one that didn't, a recipient that doesn't exist and one that has blocked the current user, failing API requests in the services that trigger the catch block, and finally the happy path. Yes, we can test this with integration tests. We could mock the request with, for example, mock service worker, then we'd render the app, fill in the form inputs, click the submit button, and check that the UI shows the correct result. But this is relatively complex, as we need to set up different mock requests. Additionally, these tests would be relatively slow, as we'd have to walk through the same UI interactions for each test. So what's the solution? Similar to the previous video, the idea is to move the business logic that is unrelated to the UI to a separate function. We then create a custom hook to facilitate dependency injection. This helps us simplify our tests. No need for an integration test for each branch. Instead, we can unit test the business logic. Let's start with the first step, extracting the business logic to a separate function. Quick side note, in this series of videos we roughly follow the clean architecture. In this context, the business logic we extracted is referred to as application logic or use cases that belong to the application layer. To keep things clear, we create the function in a new global application folder. Later, we'll restructure this project to use a feature-driven folder structure, but for now it's easier to separate the different layers and their respective folders. The pasted code needs a few adjustments. First, we need to import the services. Next, instead of updating the error state in the component, the function should return an error. The component is then responsible for the state update. At the end of the function, we need to add a catch clause where we return an error as well. We're still getting an error on the error messages. Let's move them over from the component file. Okay, we're getting closer. Next, the function parameters. We don't have access to the form event anymore, as this is the responsibility of the component. Instead, we expect message and files as parameters. The final parameter is missing, the shout ID. And finally, I forgot to return an error in the catch clause. Alright, seems like we're fine now. Now this function contains no code related to the UI or React, except for maybe the error messages that could be replaced by some kind of error codes. Even if we migrated to another UI framework, we could keep this code without any changes. Anyway, let's continue with the refactoring. Next, we create a bearer file and export the reply to shout function. Now the component. The component submit handler becomes much slimmer with all this logic isolated in the reply to shout function. Instead of the try catch, we await the function and check its return value for an error. Alright, we covered our potential future, let's migrate to another UI framework scenario. But testability-wise, not much changed, so let's tackle that. In the second step of this refactoring, we create a custom hook to facilitate dependency injection. Let me show you what that means. The reply to shout function uses a couple of services to send API requests. This means it has dependencies on these services. That makes testing the reply shout function difficult. We'd have to mock the service modules or the REST API used in the services. That's where dependency injection comes in. Dependency injection is a common pattern used to increase testability. Sounds complicated, but actually it's quite simple. First, we create an object that contains all the service functions. These are the dependencies of the reply to shout function. Then we adjust the function to accept these dependencies as new parameter. Now we can replace all direct calls to the services by the functions coming from the dependencies parameter. Finally, we create a custom hook that injects these dependencies. Note that this file became a bit dirty. If we followed the clean architecture by the book, the application layer shouldn't contain any references to the UI framework. This file contains code that is specific to the UI framework though, here by exporting a hook and applying use callback. So this file isn't completely clean. But I think we can be pragmatic here. Quick side note, if you think this looks more and more like a typical React query hook, I agree. In one of the next videos, we'll introduce React query into the picture, but for now, let's stay tool agnostic. Anyway, let's adjust the bearer file quickly. Instead of the reply to shout function, we expose the hook. That's the advantage of bearer files. We can control which parts of this module the outside should consume. Finally, let's adjust the component. Instead of calling reply to shout directly, we access the function now through the hook. That's it. Okay, it's time for the last step, the unit test. This is a bit lengthy, so let me paste the final code. At the top, we have quite a bit of setup code to create the mocks. In a larger project, this would typically be extracted factor functions that are responsible for creating mock data. Also, with a bit more effort, we could use TypeScript as another layer of safety net, but that would go too far for this time. We'll cover it in a future video. Still, let me explain quickly. Currently, we can pass anything we want as mock dependencies. We could return a string instead of the correct user object. This would mean we have a mismatch between the real service function and this mock. So you can imagine that we could end up in a situation where all our in-unit tests pass, but the application as a whole breaks. This scenario is usually covered by integration or end-to-end tests. Since these test the features integrated into the larger system, a mismatch between mocks and actual implementation quickly becomes evident. Anyway, let's continue with the unit tests. In each of these tests, we adjust the mock function to return the desired value. Like here, we return a user that has shouted already 5 times in the past day. Then we call the reply to shout function with the parameters and mock dependencies. And finally, we assert that the result matches our expectations. Here we check that the correct error message is returned. With these unit tests, we covered all the edge cases of the reply to shout function. There's no need anymore to test all these branches in integration tests that would require mocking half a dozen different user responses and run through all UI interactions for each of those branches. On top of that, these unit tests are blazing fast. Okay, that's it for this refactoring. Let me quickly wrap up with a summary of the advantages and disadvantages of extracting business logic as we did in this video. First, the advantages. First, isolating business logic from the UI makes it independent from the UI framework. Second, using dependency injection makes it easy to test the logic. Third, moving logic from the components lets them focus on their responsibility, the UI. Fourth, you finally have a place to put your business logic apart from utility functions and custom hooks. But what about the disadvantages? To be honest, I don't see many, but here are a few thoughts. First, there's a bit of overhead because we created a custom hook for dependency injection. Second, this kind of separation is only valuable if you in fact have logic. You don't need it for a simple API request. Third, it might not be that simple to distinguish between different types of logic. At least it took me a while to become better at identifying logic that's worth being extracted. Fourth, we introduced an architecture that is not very common in React apps, so new developers have to get used to it. Overall, the advantages in this case outweigh any potential disadvantages from my perspective. Okay, that's it for this video. This time we talked a lot about business or application logic. Next time we'll take a step closer to the core and focus on domain logic. In fact, we've seen this logic mixed with business logic in the use case function that we worked on today. The next step is to move this kind of logic to the domain layer.